even a cracker and a cup of coffee can help to remind us of God's grace and how God in Christ offers communion to us. So let's see the picture of Clifton and Graham lighting a candle at their home. And if you have one near you right now, you might want to light your own candle. We light candles as a reminder that Jesus Christ is the light of the world and the Holy Spirit lights our way to truth. Today is also All Saints' Day, and candles are often used as a reminder of those whom we have loved and lost, but are still present with us through the power of the Spirit in the communion of saints. Now, as we move more deeply into worship, I invite you to take a few deep breaths, remembering that into you God has breathed the breath of life. Be present in your body, in that space wherever you are, knowing that God is right there with you, longing for you to offer your life, your heart, your mind, as we worship God. Grace and peace and welcome in the name of Christ to the worship of the community of Clifton Presbyterian Church. Whether you are here at our live Zoom gathering or watching on YouTube, we are so glad that although we are separated through distance and time, we are yet united by the power of the Holy Spirit. I am Pastor Diane Walton Hendricks, and I'll be leading worship along with Rich and Lynn Coyle, who are serving as our liturgists this morning. And of course, you will be hearing from our virtual choir, ably led and edited by our director of music, John Kim. Our soloist leading us on the hymns is Hannah Harris. And now in your own space, join as Rich and Lynn lead us in the gathering words, which will be followed by the opening hymn.
It is time for all God's people to praise the Lord. May we let go all that distracts and weighs us down and come in the assurance of God's love.
We come with grateful hearts and thankful spirits. Let us open our eyes to see the abundance of God's gifts. Let us open our ears to hear the generosity of God's love. Let us take our place among the faithful of all ages. Amen.
For saints who from their labors rest to thee by faith before the world confessed. Thy name, O Jesus, be forever blessed. Alleluia, Alleluia.
Alleluia. Rich and Lynn will lead us in the call to confession, the prayer of confession, and the assurance of God's grace.
Our lives are full of mistakes and errors, places where we follow self-generated idols instead of the one true God. We are not alone in these mistakes. All of those who have come before us also were plagued with temptation and sin. Let us come before God, just as generations of believers have done, and pray for God's forgiveness and grace. Let us pray.
O God of the ages, have mercy on us. We do not always love as you would have us love. We do not always do as you would have us do. In our stubbornness, we turn from you when we should turn toward you. Hold us, eternal God. Comfort us when we mourn the passing of friends and family, and help us to trust that they are rejoicing in your presence. We praise you for the grace you pour out on us, constantly forgiving our errors, especially the ones that we don't share with any but you. Hear now the silent fears and worries of our hearts. Please take a moment for your personal prayers.
This we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior.
Amen.
Friends, hear the good news. Though thousands upon thousands of our ancestors did not follow God's ways perfectly, we have hope in the one who did. Jesus, born of a particular people in a particular time, taught through his words and deeds that God has already forgiven us. And so we and all who have come before us are rightly known as saints, the holy ones of God. Thanks be to God for God's mercy, love, and grace.
Alleluia. Amen.
Join Hannah in singing Gloria, which will be followed by Lynn and Rich sharing, leading us in the sharing of Christ's peace.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
In Christ, we have been forgiven and freed by God, and so we dare to claim our place among the communion of saints through the ages who love God. Since we have been made one with God and one with each other in Christ, let us share Christ's peace with those who are nearby and offer hopes of peace for those who are far off, and consider how we can be peacemakers in our lives.
Thanks be to God. As we gather to worship on this All Saints Day, we gather in a way unlike how the saints of Clifton Presbyterian Church ever gathered before. And yet we trust that by the power of the Spirit, we are still one people with each other and with the communion of saints through the ages who rest in God. Those who have gone before us had their own struggles and trials in their times, and we have ours. And yet we hope in Christ, who has promised us that when we are faithful with what we have, that God will provide what we need to proclaim the gospel in our community. Let us continue to give generously, offering to God the gifts of our lives, our tithes, our talents, and our very selves. Now join Rich and Lynn in the prayer of dedication.
Let us pray.
Great and glorious Savior, we listen attentively to your voice. We place our trust in your truth and grace. We generously give in gratitude for your truth in our spiritual journey. We pray that our monetary gifts may help others to see your kingdom, to draw closer to you, and to find ultimate peace. We pray in the name of the one who sustains us throughout life's journey, the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. Amen.
Now join Hannah in the sung prayer for illumination, which will be followed by the gospel lesson.
Open my ears that I may hear voices of truth you send so clear. And while the wave notes fall on my ear, everything false will disappear. Silently now I wait for thee, ready, my God, your will to see. Open my ears, illumine me, Spirit divine.
The gospel reading for today, Matthew 5, verses 1 through 12. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Be my truth, be my life, my Lord.
Amen. About 20 years after Jesus' crucifixion, Paul arrived in Corinth, which was a wealthy and cosmopolitan city, a crossroads for trades and an international melting pot. And there he preached the gospel, and a community of believers was formed. Paul lived with them for about a year and a half, nurturing them in their faith before moving on to Ephesus, where scholars believe he wrote the first letter to the Corinthians. It seems that the Corinthians had written to him to ask him about several questions that they had, and as their father in faith, they valued his opinion. In the section of the letter that we will read, Paul is speaking generally about a life of faith for those who have been entrusted with the gospel of Christ. In the very first verse that I will read, Paul writes to think about us. The us that he is referring to are the leaders of the early church that the Corinthians knew about. Leaders like Peter or Apollos, a different Christian missionary, or Paul himself. These leaders are to be considered examples of what it looks like to live a life that follows Christ. So with that background, listen now to the word of the Lord. Think of us in this way, as servants of Christ and stewards of God's mysteries. Moreover, it is required of stewards that they be found trustworthy. But with me, it is a very small thing that I should be judged by you or by any human court. I do not even judge myself. I am not aware of anything against myself, but I am not thereby acquitted. It is the Lord who judges me. Therefore, do not pronounce judgment before the time, before the Lord comes, who will bring to light the things now hidden in darkness and will disclose the purposes of the heart. Then each one will receive commendation from God. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I remember doing trust falls when I was young. We would do them with each other out on the playground, and I loved that feeling of falling, though maybe not as much as I loved the feeling of being securely caught at the end. I discovered that a good trust fall was more about the person who was catching than the person who was falling. Now, there were times, of course, that some catcher would deliberately let someone fall to the ground. Those were the kids who seemed to think they were funny, but they were just mean. If a person like that was your partner, you learned real quick that you had to put your foot back real fast and catch yourself, or else you'd be hurting. More often, there were kids who really tried to catch the person who was falling. They really wanted to, but they just weren't coordinated or strong enough for a really good long trust fall. They might break your fall at the end, but they couldn't properly catch you. You could discover the best partners in a trust fall in steps. You would start with someone right behind your back, leaning back just a little bit, and almost everybody could catch you then. And then you'd separate by another step, and then another, and then another. The great fun was finding someone who could let you fall almost all the way to the ground, but never let you hit. In today's scripture passage from 1 Corinthians, Paul seems to be asserting that he is a really good partner to have in the biblical equivalent of a trust fall. Think of us in this way, as servants of Christ and stewards of God's mysteries. Moreover, it is required of stewards that they be found trustworthy. Paul seems to understand what philosopher Nora O'Neill asserted in her 2013 TED Talk about the role of trust in public life. O'Neill took issue with the commonly held assumption that more trust is needed to make the world a better place. She argued that the proper aim is not to increase trust in general, but for people to trust those who are trustworthy. She pointed out that trust is a response given to trustworthiness given. There is a relationship between the two, just like a child's experience of a trust fall. So if we are people who think that more trust in the world is a good thing, then we ought to be more trustworthy people. Most of us want to be trustworthy, I think. At least those of us who are coming together on a Sunday morning to be with each other and to be with God. We want to grow in trustworthiness. We want to be individuals, a community that others trust. But sometimes, in spite of our best intentions, we fail at being trustworthy. Sometimes we promise too much, we overcommit ourselves. And then even when we can manage to keep all of those promises, we become resentful of the toll that it takes upon our lives. I wonder if that has ever happened to you. As a pastor, I often am in the position of asking people to do this or that for church. And I really appreciate and much prefer to ask someone that I know will tell me no if they can't do it, or if they feel like they don't have time for it or aren't well suited to do it. A kindly spoken no can be an excellent way of growing in trustworthiness, because then when you say yes, it can be a wholehearted, enthusiastic yes that invites a greater trust from others. Sometimes also, we don't keep promises that we could have. Now, there can be very good reasons to break promises. Illness, injury, emergencies are a part of life. But sometimes we break promises not because we must, but because to keep them would be hard. I wonder if you know what that feels like. Maybe it was a casual promise, like the promise to bring donuts to the office. Or maybe it was a promise to someone who was really counting on it, like promising a child to watch their sporting event. Or maybe it was a promise that you made to yourself, like promising to call your sponsor instead of picking up that drink. When we do not promise too much, and when we keep the promises that we make, we are found trustworthy, and others can take a step back and enjoy a little more. Think of us in this way, the Apostle Paul writes, as servants of Christ and stewards of God's mysteries. Moreover, it is required of stewards that they be found trustworthy. Now, I've always found that word steward to be kind of archaic and churchy. We use it around this time of year in the church when we talk about stewardship campaigns, or more generally, when we talk about being good stewards of God's earth. About the only other way that I remember it being used in my lifetime was when I was growing up, what we tend to call flight attendants today. When I was growing up, we called them stewards or stewardesses. The word literally means one who keeps or guards a household and its estates. In biblical times, stewards would ensure that everyone who was a part of the running of the household was both properly cared for and properly doing their part. So when Paul states that he and the other leaders that the Corinthians respect are good stewards, then he's implying that they are faithful in guarding and keeping the household, the family, the community of which they have been given charge. And for Paul, the community of which they have been given charge is the community that proclaims the gospel of Jesus Christ, the great mystery that God has given to the world in the saving life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. Paul is saying to the Corinthians, look at those of us that you know and respect. You know and respect us because we live our lives in accordance to the gift that God has given to us. That is the stewardship that we are invited into as well, as followers of Christ. We have been invited to continue to participate in furthering the witness of the saints through the ages of Clifton Presbyterian Church. This year, as we have celebrated our 150th anniversary, we have been reminded of the ways that through the decades, the church has stewarded what was given to it. The troubles of this 2020 year has challenged us into new ways of being faithful in our stewardship, as we have been prevented from doing things the way we have always done them before. Instead, we've had to be creative, considering new ways of living out old truths. We are called to be faithful, trustworthy stewards individually and as a community. In the weeks to come, we will be reflecting on this theme of being found faithful, found trustworthy. One of the most obvious questions that arises when we consider that theme is, well, who are we going to be found trustworthy by? One answer to that might be ourselves. Do we think that we ourselves are worthy of trust? Another answer might be those who are closest to us, our family, our community. Another answer might be those who don't know us, strangers, the world. But according to Paul's assertion, for those of us who are followers of Christ, we are most concerned about the judgment of God. And God is the most gracious, most true, most generous partner to have in this trust fall of faith. For God will ever and always give us opportunities to grow in trustworthiness. Indeed, God is the only partner who offers faith in us before we are found faithful. While we were yet sinners, the scripture tells us, Christ died for us. It is like God comes down into the playground of life and offers to be partners of anyone who wants to take a shot of it. Even the jokester who has dropped kids so many times that everybody else steers clear. God comes to each of us, whether we have been found faithful before or not, and gives us the precious gift of hope and life and love, falling for us again and again and again and again, always giving us another chance to grow in faithfulness, another chance to be found trustworthy with the gift of our lives. And of course, it might go without saying, but never should go without saying, that God, the God made known in Christ Jesus, came to this world for our sake, traveling through the darkest valleys of betrayal and death, and went even to the cross, even to the grave, so that we might know there is no place we might fall, that God is not right there, waiting to catch us, and has been raised so that we know that the arms into which we fall are stronger than the bonds of death itself, always able to catch us and keep us from falling. And now to the one who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than we could ask or ever imagine. To God be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus now and forevermore. Amen. As we move to the table of grace, Hannah will lead us in song.
We gather here in Jesus' name. His love is burning through our hearts like living flame. For through the loving Son, the Father makes us one. Come take the bread, come drink the wine, come share the Lord.
My friends, this is the joyful feast of the people of God. No matter what your little corner looks like, Jesus Christ is the host at our table and always invites us to eat with him. And you have invited Christ into your home and now are invited to let him take his place at the head of the table. It is written that people will come from east and west and north and south and sit at table with our risen Lord. According to Luke, when our Savior was at dinner with his disciples, our risen Lord was at dinner with his disciples, he took bread and blessed and broke it, and their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. This is our Savior's table. The Lord invites all who trust in him to share the feast that he has prepared. Let us join our hearts together in prayer. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give God thanks and praise. It is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise, eternal God. For in the beginning, you called the world to yourself and looked upon it and called it good. And in the fullness of time in Jesus Christ, you spoke the word that brought the world into being. By the Holy Spirit, you brought order out of chaos and breathed life into your creatures. In parental love, you stood by us in spite of our disobedience, correcting us with gracious reproof and welcoming us again into your loving embrace. We give you thanks for Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. He came to dwell among us full of grace and truth. To all who believed, he gave power to become your children. In ministry among your beloved, Jesus cared for all, forgiving their failures, healing their hurts, and nurturing their faith, giving himself in utter sacrifice for those he loved. He inspired ordinary people to spirit-filled living and displayed in his life, death, and rising again the power of your spirit. Remembering your gracious act in Jesus Christ, we take from your creation this bread and this cup and joyfully celebrate his dying and rising as we await the day of his coming. With thanksgiving, we offer our very selves to you to be a living and holy sacrifice dedicated to your service. And now we offer our prayers on behalf of the world. We pray for your church. Open us to ways we can share your unchanging love in these unprecedented times. We pray for all who are fearful, anxious, and suspicious as we approach Election Day. We ask for your wisdom and grace to prevail. By your Spirit, make a way forward. We pray for the sick, the sorrowing, and all who suffer in body, mind, or circumstance. Especially, we pray for those whom we know to be in need. Encourage them and give them hope. Rejoicing in the communion of saints, we remember with thanksgiving all of your faithful servants and those dear to us, whom you have called from this life. And we name them out loud, or in the silence of our hearts. We are grateful that for them, death is no more, nor is there sorrow or crying or pain, for the former things have passed away. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of bread and wine, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be a communion in the body and blood of Christ. Keep us faithful in your service until Christ comes in final victory, and we shall feast with all your saints in the joy of your eternal realm. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty Father, now and forevermore. Amen. And now we offer the prayer that Christ taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The Lord Jesus Christ, on the night of his betrayal, took bread. And when he had blessed it, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. And in the same way, he took the cup, and said, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Drink all of it." Whenever we eat the bread, whenever we drink the cup, we proclaim the saving death of our risen Lord until he comes again. My friends, these are God's gifts to us. Whatever you hold in your hand is God's gift to us. And somehow, we know not how, through the power of the Holy Spirit, as we share these gifts, then we are somehow one with God, one with each other, and one with all who share this feast through the ages. Come, eat the bread and share the cup. Let us pray. God of abundance, with the bread of life and the cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And so, having been fed at the table, we are strengthened to go out into the world to share God's love that has been entrusted to us. So there's several things that we're going to take a moment to remember in the life of our community. As I mentioned in my sermon, we are starting stewardship season. So we have a minute for stewardship, or maybe a little bit more than a minute for stewardship, from Bruno Maestri. And there's a video that John is going to share with us.
Good morning. I'm Bruno Maestri, and as your elder for stewardship, I'm here in our sanctuary to announce our 2021 stewardship campaign. First, let me start by thanking each of you for your generosity during this past year, a year that's certainly had its share of challenges, particularly the manner in which we've had to worship. Our goal for 2021 is $300,000, and we'll be sharing budget details and information in the coming weeks via email on our webpage and via mail, to all this to assist you as you discern your own estimate of giving for next year. We'll have both a mail-in and an online option for you to get feedback to us. And we hope to hear from everyone by November 22nd, 3 weeks from today, Dedication Sunday. You know, budgets are all about numbers, like salaries, facilities, mortgages, but these numbers translate to what gives us purpose: our worship, congregational care, care for one another, community service and outreach, mission, both near and far. In other words, the mission and ministry we are called to do as a church. Today is All Saints' Day, and this church is here because of the faithfulness of the many saints who came before us in our rich 150-year heritage. That trust has been passed to all of us to ensure that those that come after us have this place, this heritage, this demonstration of God's presence. As we've heard each month from the anniversary committee, CPC members have been faithful, resilient, and adaptive throughout our history. We now join those saints in the call to be faithful. And certainly we've shown we are able to adapt in this time we are experiencing, adapting in our worship, in our support of each other, in our learning, in how we serve the community, and in so many other ways. We continue to see God's work in our midst and our own need to continue work as his hands, his feet, his ears, and his voice each day. Some of our members have shared how God continues to be revealed to them during this time. And I'll close with their thoughts as shown in this brief set of slides. Thank you, and I'll see you next week.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see.
And I think if Mark is available, we have a minute for mission. Mark, are you with us?
Yes, I'm here.
Great.
I don't know that you can see me, but I hope you can hear me. And I encourage each of you to read the weekly update that you receive. And on pages 4 and 5, they highlight some of the things we're doing. Our thanks to all for helping us to fill the truck. We delivered 709 pounds of food to WFCM. We're involved in a new part of mission there where we're on every Wednesday morning, we are gathering food from Walmart in Chantilly and delivering that to WFCM. Rich Coyle is helping us with that if we have an overload. And there's opportunities for others to participate in that part of the mission. And we'll always be collecting food at the church, and our cooler will always be at the front door. So during the week, if you leave food, we'll see that it gets to WFCM in a regular way. Then also during November, we'll be busy helping to provide food baskets to families so that they're sure at Thanksgiving time they can have a meal. And some of you have already contributed, others may contribute. You can send a check to the church and we'll see that it gets to WFCM to help that. And then 2 weeks from today is sort of the conclusion of the crop walk. It's a virtual crop walk. And it's actually been going on for 2 weeks, but you'll find listed in there that you can just go online. You'll find the email there. And when you get in, they'll guide you through a long process, but you need to be sure to list that you're participating as part of the Clifton Presbyterian Church, not just CPC, but the Clifton Presbyterian Church. But however you give, we'll see that the money gets to Crop Walk and Church World Service. So that's how we reach out to the world around us at this time of year, that they all know that we have concerns. And then I remind my mission committee that we meet on Wednesday at 6 o'clock, and you'll receive a Zoom link in the next day or two so that you can tie into the mission committee. And if you have things we need to consider, contact me so that I can include it in the agenda. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Mark. Appreciate that. And one more minute to be brought to you, a minute for leadership. Bill Watts, our clerk of session, is going to share what happened at last week's session meeting.
Thank you, Pastor Diane. We had a very good meeting. It didn't last too long, which is always good. I'm going to start off with pastor's time. Our new pastor laid out her goals for the next 3 months, what she wants to do. And I'm sure she will be sharing that with everyone over time. Our pastor's day off, for everybody to note, is Friday. And then on Mondays, she'll be working from home. And then she's in the working from the church the rest of the week, Tuesday through Thursday. Porch time will continue, of course, weather dependent, today being no different. we are planning, everybody should take note, December 13th will be the installation which the presbytery performs for us, where we actually have the installation of Pastor Diane as our installed pastor. Pastor Diane also had a very interesting comment, which is very good, that she likes the Presbyterian tradition of parity between the teacher teaching and ruling elders. Session and pastor share. We can disagree and we can discuss it so that we come to the right place. Session members, we need to speak up early and often. Very good advice. From our admin and finance committee, currently our pledges are a bit behind projections. We still estimate, I think last month I pointed out that we expect to finish the year at about 90% of our pledge goal, and that yields an approximately $20,000 deficit. Our current unrestricted funds in the church are $142,000. Elder Jim Wrightson has prepared a projected budget for 2021, which, as everyone knows, I'm sure, is highly dependent on what happens with the pandemic. Speaking of which, the ad hoc committee report, I'm sure everybody watches the news, and that this current pandemic situation continues to decline. Currently, we may have to suspend indoor meetings, but so far outdoor meetings are still going along. Of our committees, preschool is doing well. Stewardship, you just heard from Elder Maestri. Our elder for worship, Beth Korish, reports that we're going to have a living nativity this year on December 6th. A living nativity from 4 to 6 o'clock. Please note that the Clifton Betterment Association is participating with us for that funding. So thanks be to God. Fellowship and outreach continues. The book club, Ben's Breakfast, and Thursday Lunch Club also are being held via Zoom. Mission, you have also already heard from Mark Reimers, and personnel committee, when we're ever able to get back into the church and have worship inside, we do have a new nursery assistant, Amy Nagel. And that's the report from session. Thank you, Pastor Diane.
Thank you, Bill. Appreciate that. This evening, we were hoping that we would be able to gather outdoors for an evening Vespers service, but unfortunately, it does not look like the weather is cooperating with us yet again. So I will send out a note shortly sharing that. So we'll look ahead a week, and hopefully if the weather cooperates and if our COVID numbers stay in the safe range, then we will be able to gather outside next week. So pray pray for a sunny day next Sunday. Those are all the announcements. And before we move into our time of going out into the world, we will hear the ringing of our bell, which rings us into the world. As followers of Christ, we do remember that we are sent into the world. So wherever you go this week, consider that God is sending you there. Wherever you find yourself this week, consider that God is placing you there, so that the love of God, which has been entrusted to you, can reach out to the world around you, even if that is just within your own home. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Alleluia. Amen. Join Hannah in singing the benediction response.
All praise and thanks to God the Father now be given, the Son and Him who reigns with them in highest heaven, the one eternal God whom earth and heaven adore. For thus it was, is now, and shall be evermore.
Thanks to all of us, all of you who have joined us via YouTube. We certainly are glad that you have found your way to the community of Clifton Presbyterian Church, and we look forward to worshiping with you virtually again next week. And for those of us who are on the live Zoom link, I invite you to stay on, and we'll have a time of community praying and caring and sharing with one another.